Throughout history, the fallen have given mankind the stories and myths that would mock the Messiah before he came in the flesh to minister. Because of planting these lies in the minds of the learned, the story of Horus became the most famous and accepted by academia. I repeat, these are not your ancestors. They are devils, spirits that need you to open up portals and doorways as well as yourself and let them into this reality. All the other Messiah figures are sloppy copies. The fallen tried their best to duplicate the story of the coming Christ, but as usual, their mockery of his life and walk does not fool those with a solid connection to the Most High. The New Age, or Aeon of Horus, is part of the Masonic blueprint to create a new Atlantis, first out of America, then the world. Atlantis is believed to be the perfect example of perfected man in his utopian society. Advanced technology, life extension, designer children, and DNA manipulation were some of the things that made Atlantis so advanced, Masons believe. A home for marine spirits, in truth, the Brotherhood see it as a new blueprint for the new world. In Atlantis, there was no attention paid to race, gender, or religion. Only the pursuit of self-improvement mattered to the society as a whole. Well, we're almost there. Be watchful and pray as we together take this voyage to their new Atlantis.
If I go on my way without you, oh, where would I go? Set sail with me, misty lady, set my spirit free. I'll always come back.
My parents were from different worlds. Different worlds. And I was a product of a love that never should have been. Never should have been.
He could unite our worlds one day. He could unite our worlds one day. He could unite our worlds one...
A son of the land. And a son of the seas. A son of the land. And a son of the seas.
Your mother always knew you were special.
You are part of something deeper. You are the bridge between land and sea. Take your rightful place as king.
We're getting close now.
Oh yeah? Close to what? Dying of thirst? There's no way Atlantis were this far inland.
Check this place out. This is badass!
It's real. Nothing.
Of course it's not working. It's been sitting here collecting dust since before the Sahara was a desert.
Before the Sahara was a desert. Let's just say you do your best thinking when you're not thinking at all. All right, now hold still.
Hey, what are you doing?
We need water near the closest source.
Show off. I could have just peed on it.
In this trident resides the power of Atlantis. If you seek my power, journey beyond the edge of the world to the journey beyond the edge of the world to the hidden sea. In the wrong hands, it would bring destruction. But in the hands of the true heir, it would unite all our kingdoms, above and below, above and below.
The beast has awakened. The beast has awakened. The time has come for Atlantis to rise again.
Continue and back it up with a lot of facts. Remember, a lot of the meat of this little mini series that we're doing this week comes from a book entitled Scarlet and the Beast, written by John Daniel. Now, we've covered a lot of territory, and one of the points that I made is that the Beast must resemble with at least 14 points exactly ancient Rome. So we'll begin tonight setting out some of these similarities between Rome and the United States of America. From 100 to 300 AD, most of pagan Rome converted to Christianity. And when this nation was founded, 67% of America's population was Christian. Christians in Rome suffered severe persecution. Christians in America were fleeing European persecution. Rome, ladies and gentlemen, in its time was the melting pot of the world. And today, one of the well-known phrases is that America is the melting pot of the world. Rome was a democracy based upon a two-party system, the optimates and the populares. And the United States of America, they say, is a democracy. It was really founded as a republic, but today, a democracy based upon a two-party system, the Democrats and the Republicans. Rome had a divided balance of power. The Roman Tribune and his Senate. America has a divided balance of power, the American president and his Congress. Rome was based on specific laws. They had 12 tables. America is based on specific laws, our Constitution. Rome protected the rights of its citizens. America, up until recently, protected the rights of its citizens. In Rome, all men were equal. That was the international law of Rome. In America, all men are equal according to the Declaration of Independence. But let me set that straight. All men in the Declaration of Independence were created equal. All men are not equal. And in Rome, all men, even though they said they were equal, were not. Those are facts. Look in history and you will see. Rome had a sordid history of slavery. America also had a sordid history of slavery. Rome was capitalistic. America is capitalistic. Rome practiced abortion as a means of population control. And the United States of America practices abortion as a form of birth control. Rome loved R-rated entertainment. Look at the history of Pompeii. And here in the United States of America, we protect R-rated entertainment under the First Amendment as freedom of speech. Rome had a welfare program funded by taxes. You all know that we also have a welfare budget, and many take advantage of it. In fact, our welfare budget rivals our military budget. Rome had a thriving business in lawsuits. America also has a thriving business in lawsuits. Sports was Rome's pastime. And in America, football dominates fall and winter, basketball winter and spring, and baseball spring and summer. And I know some men who don't know anything more than the sports statistics for their favorite teams. And they think they're brilliant because of it. Ancient Rome's national emblem was the single-headed eagle pointing west. America's national emblem is the single-headed eagle pointing west. From 300 to 500 A.D., the Roman Church was weakened spiritually because of pagan infiltration. And after 200 years, the Church in America has also been weakened spiritually because of Masonic infiltration, which is nothing more than the ancient pagan religion of Babylon. So we have not only met 14, ladies and gentlemen, we've gone beyond 14, if you were counting. Most historians also attribute the name America to the explorer Amerigo Vespucci. Freemasonry, however, has a different point of view, and this will be new to most of you. For according to Freemasonry and author Manly Hall, a 33rd degree Freemason, the Indians in Central and South America say the name came from their gods who were peace-loving. For example, the supreme god of the Mayan culture of Central America was known as Quetzalcoatl, a light-skinned god who wore a long white robe covered with red crosses. Carved in the stones of his temples were serpents. Quetzalcoatl was known as the peace-loving serpent god. Serpent god. The same god in Peru was known as Ameru, the god of peace. He was pictured as a plumed serpent. Ameru's territory was known as Amaruca. The 1895 issue of the publication called Lucifer, a periodical published by Freemason Blavatsky's Theosophical Society, states this, quote, "From the latter comes our word America. Amaruca is literally translated land of the plumed serpent. The priests of this god of peace once ruled the Americas. All the red men who have remained true to the ancient religion are still under his sway." And according to author William T. Still, Manly Hall claims that since the serpent is frequently symbolic of Lucifer, it is no exaggeration to extrapolate from this that America may well mean, quote, land of Lucifer, end quote. We already have discussed the hierarchy in Freemasonry and that they consider Lucifer to be the good, benevolent, and peace-loving God. Their philosophy is known as the Luciferian philosophy, and it goes something like this. Man was held prisoner by an unjust, vindictive, and jealous God in the Garden of Eden. He was bound in the chains of ignorance. Man was set free by Lucifer through his agent, Satan, when man was given the gift of intellect, and through the use of this intellect, man himself will become God. That is the Luciferian promise, the promise of Satan to Eve in the Garden of Eden. America is known as the good, benevolent, and peace-loving nation. We've also discussed the seal of the Illuminati, the unfinished pyramid. Its capstone and its all-seeing eye represents the kingdom of Lucifer. The image of this Luciferian masterpiece makes up half of the great seal of the United States of America. Just look at a $1 bill. And Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 12, tells us that Lucifer was the epitome of beauty, America the Beautiful, may therefore be a sinister figure of speech for Lucifer the Beautiful. Freemason Manly P. Hall states that when Atlantis died, so did the ideal pattern of government. According to Hall, the League of Ten Kings is part of the secret doctrine preserved by secret societies through their oral traditions. Hall believes that when the unifying force of the Ten Kings was broken, destruction automatically followed. So complete was this destruction, he writes, that men forgot there is a better way of life and accepted the evils of war and crime and poverty as inevitable. The old Atlantis is gone, dissolved in a sea of human doubts, but the philosophical empire would come again as a democracy of wise men. This connects directly with the protocols of the wise men of Sion. Freemasonry planned long ago to philosophically raise Atlantis out of the sea, and in this new land reestablish democracy as a new world order, Novus Ordo Cyclorum. Masonic author George H. Steinmetz confirms in Freemasonry its hidden meaning that the democratic philosophy of Freemasonry has been traced back to the lost continent of Atlantis. He attempts to prove that Atlantis was a Masonic society by suggesting that the destroyed temples of Upper Egypt are all part of that Atlantean destruction. There, in Egypt, we find their ruined temples, which compared with our lodge rooms, have similar floor plans, the same dark north, and many of the same emblems. And remember, in The Lion King, to the north was darkness and desolation. Finally, Steinmetz says that one cannot understand the universality of Freemasonry without accepting the Atlantean account. Hall concurs. Masonry is a university teaching the liberal arts and sciences of the soul to all who will attend to its words. It is a shadow of the great Atlantean mystery school which stood with all its splendor in the ancient city of the Golden Gates, where now the turbulent Atlantic rolls in unbroken sweep. And I bet you wondered why they named the bridge in San Francisco the Golden Gate Bridge. Now you know. Hall suggests that the antediluvian civilization was democratic, that Freemasonry planned over three centuries ago to recreate a universal democratic society that will philosophically rise up out of the sea, and like Atlantis, join with ten kings to lead mankind in the pursuit of universal happiness. And what is the sea? Remember, the sea is the mass of humanity, great numbers of people. To rise up out of the sea is to establish through revolution, and that's coming. He says that the Christian church has delayed the search for the new Atlantis, and that's why they hate Christians, and Christians, like Orthodox Jews and the followers of the Prophet Muhammad, are scheduled for extermination in the New World Order. And he alludes to the ancient Roman Empire as the last attempt at resurrection of the Atlantean project, and states that another attempt would be made. Now, we can see how Freemasonry's planned resurrection of Atlantis correlates with Daniel's prophecy of a revived Roman Empire. Likewise, John's vision of the beast with ten horns, representing ten kings, is more significant in this regard, given the fact that Freemasonry calls for its one-world government to be patterned after the Atlantean League of Ten Kings.
Ancient pictographs will show you depictions of waves of water going back to the very first civilizations. This depiction is also found in conjunction with the understanding or overstanding of spirit as those ancient people knew it. Oftentimes the same symbol that would be used to signify body of water or the movement or motion of water or actual water waves would also be used to symbolize the spirit, the moving of the spirit realm. You can also look at a very common hermetic inversion model, the one that uses the hexagram with the magician looking down into the water, looking at his reflection, and it completes the bottom half of the picture, or the bottom half of the hexagram. In that depiction, we see this idea of water as being something of a spiritual nature, an equal opposite companion, if you will, to this physical realm, and being the other half of it, the other half that completes
this physical realm. Well, what you see with Atlantis is an attempt to bring that spiritual realm into this physical reality. And not just to bring it in, but to mix it in with this physical reality and really create confusion and chaos, out of which they intend to bring a new world order. And it's interesting that what the brotherhoods and the alchemists, the so-called alchemists, know, and what they don't want us to know, is that it is really the physical realm that is a reflection of the spiritual and not the other way around, as they're trying to create a society now that is so spiritually blind and materially driven that they're unable to discern the things of the spirit. They aren't operating in the spirit to even test the spirit, and so therefore the demonic can be passed on to them as something holy or ancient pagan devilish practices and ideas can be packaged as new age philosophies and things that help to bring man back into this Atlantean perfection that the Masons and the Brotherhoods say that they're working towards, which is a lie. They know that it's all going to lead toward destruction, and just a way to create a Luciferian society in mass. And yes, it's all about the pride, like the Isley Brothers said. When it comes down to it, the same thing that caused Lucifer to fall is the very favorite stumbling block that he likes to put before mankind. So he plays off of mankind's arrogance and mankind's desire to, you know, fulfill his destiny to be like God in the ways that God commanded. You know, that's an internal thing for man to want to do that. However, it is the devil's pleasure to twist and contort that desire into a self-aggrandizing need to accomplish things and to conquer nature and to be as God, the same thing that caused the adversary to fall. So yes, bottom line is, at the end of the day, it is all about pride, the pride of life, lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, to try to reach this Atlantean perfection that we're sold and told mankind once achieved, when in reality that's a lie. We're talking about the fallen angel contorting history and inadvertently trying to get man to be as him and to fall in the same way that he did. Look at the past civilizations who followed the same model that this civilization is currently following. And it's no coincidence that Leviathan is called the king of the sons of pride. No, there's no direct biblical link to a marine realm or a marine spirit realm, but we can draw some conclusions that this Atlantean thing and the sons of pride are working hand in hand to bring forth this new Atlantis or this new age of Horus, this new world order.
My name's Veronica Strang, and I'm a cultural anthropologist, and I work partly on material culture, but most specifically on material. So my particular interest is in water, and I've been writing about different aspects of water for, I guess it must be over 30 years now. Water, of course, is a lovely topic to work on because you can really go across a whole spectrum, from the kind of crunchy political conflicts over water, issues of water management, water shortages, you know, the whole kind of environmental set of issues that we're all painfully familiar with. These days, right through to the more kind of symbolic meanings attached to water and how it takes us into sort of deep cultural ideas about the spirit and how the world works. And then, of course, there's all the wonderful science of water and its extraordinary properties. So it's a very wide subject in which you can come at it in a lot of different ways. Water beings are a sort of way of understanding the flows of the world, but they also provide a very easily understood metaphor for those kinds of movements of ideas and notions of flow. So, you know, they also contain wisdom. They also talk about the flow of knowledge through the world, as well as water, and if you believe in spiritual things, also the spirit. So they're a good way to conceptualize all of that. So if you go to parts of the world like Australia, they're very beneficent creatures by and large, but they're also extremely dangerous because they also generate ancestral law and they punish people who transgress it. So you get a lot of stories about people being swallowed by them because they've gone to somewhere sacred without proper respect, or they're not supposed to be there, or they're being greedy with fishing, whatever. But generally they are the bringers of life, but they're not soft, they're very powerful. If, on the other hand, you come to this part of the world, it's got more to do with religious transitions from nature religions through to semi-human deities, as in the Greeks and Romans, to more human pantheons, then to monotheisms. And that has to do with humans starting to think more about dominion over the world as they form larger, more hierarchical societies, but more to the point, more instrumental relationships with nature. So your most beneficent water beings are those of the nature religions, where people work in partnership with a non-human and they feel a sense of parity. It's a reciprocal partnership, and you get a real sense of that working in Aboriginal Australia, that the non-human and the sentient landscape is actually a partner with humankind. But when you start to move into societies that bring in agriculture and then in irrigation and start forming the landscape a lot more instrumentally, you see a movement in religious thought away from worshipping local water beings and other nature deities into deities who live in places like Olympus, Valhalla, whatever, and then into a far-off heaven. And the closer you get to the big patriarchal religions, the more the serpent beings are demonized, because, of course, you get that whole period in the medieval world where Christianity was extremely militant in repressing the nature religion. So you get a fluorescence of dragon slayers, and of course you've got some wonderful objects here in the museum, and you're living with God's exhibition. You've got a nice panel with St. George slaying the dragon, you've got a very rare St. George, a black St. George slaying the dragon, and you've got some other nice icons from Russia. So you get this kind of sudden emergence of the saintly heroes slaying the infidel or slaying the serpent, and fundamentally it's the same thing. It's about asserting Christian beliefs and subsuming those pagan nature worshippers. But of course they keep bubbling up, and we still have strong pagan religions in many parts of the world, and indeed in this country, and you've still got people having a very important discourse about how we relate to nature. So you get linkages between pagan religious groups, environmental groups, and of course the feminist groups for whom religious patriarchy might be less appealing. Water serpents are fascinating in that, on the one hand, they're incredibly diverse. They are all shapes and forms and, you know, so forth. And they, you know, so I was just talking a little bit about some of the objects you've got here in the museum. You've got that wonderful turquoise Mayan serpent, for example, which is a double-headed, jaguar-headed, it's the most gorgeous object. And then you've got that wonderful Japanese articulated dragon in the Living with Gods exhibition, which is just beautiful. So they're very different. You get them with horns, you get them with plumes, you get them with feathers, you get them with fishy kind of characteristic wolf heads up in the west coast of America, whale-like bodies if you get to the north and Canada. But they come in very different forms, and what they tend to do is absorb the forms of their local environment and the local flora and fauna. So there's one theory, for example, that typical rainbow serpents in Australia absorb the pipefish, which has a very dragony type head, and it's just, but mostly they're snake-like, and the reason that they're snake-like in some form or serpentine is that they represent the properties of water. So on the one hand, they have a lot of things in common. They're serpentine, they are often coloured as water, they move like water, they have the powers of water to generate life and take life. They often have a lot of jaws and teeth, and ideas about swallowing and consuming, and so forth. And sometimes they're either spitting out humans or they're consuming. And there's that notion of it being something that water can do, like a tsunami swallows whole villages and so forth. So they represent the materiality of water, which is why they have a kind of family resemblance. And at the same time, they pick up local flora and fauna. And that's partly because they are made out of people thinking with water and thinking with local flora and fauna, and partly because in generating the life in the local environment, that's what they're generating: local flora, local fauna, and of course, as we started off talking, human beings as well. So they have a tremendous power in representing not only capacities to generate and take life, but also to connect organic life, because they represent the fact that all organic living kinds depend on water, and in that sense they're all connected by water.
Balance is not the problem. Balance is a natural phenomenon in nature placed there by the Creator. The issue is in duality, trying to make equal things that are not set or supposed to be made equal, such as saying that good and evil are equal. This is the Hermetic model, and the whole idea of as above, so below is a way to make evil fair seeming, or a way to justify when they gratify themselves by giving in to the lower parts of their will, the lower parts of their personality, and saying that it's just part of the duality of life. You know, there are beliefs in the Brotherhood that you know, you do so many good deeds and you have to do so many bad deeds so that you keep this duality going, which is really the James 1 and 8 man, the double-minded man. They believe that this is balance, and it's not balance. It is anathema to the balance and order that was created by the Almighty, and it is man's feeble attempt, again, to try to be as God. And so this is the big idea of the Atlantis rising again, or the Phoenix rising again, or Rome rising again, or Babylon rising again, this rising from the ashes, this Leviathan rising from the sea. It's all based in pride. And although we see a lot of folks running to these ideas about the marine realm and the marine spirit, you know, I think that the wisest thing that we can do as believers is to stick to the scriptures, what the scripture says about a thing, and not get too wrapped up into folks' testimonies that are just simply based on spiritual experiences, which can be manipulated. Again, it's what these magicians are all about. They're all about opening realms and portals. They're all about bringing that watery realm or that spiritual realm here into this solid or physical realm. And they're all about making sure that you misconstrue the two, that you can't tell one from the other. And so that's what we have to be very cautious of. And if we let the word be our plumb line and our foundation and our guide, it's going to be very, very difficult to fool you. As it is said in Matthew 24 and 24 about the very elect. So to be one of those very elect, you have to be select about the information that you take a hold to and go running concerning. And you have to really break it down into what the word says concerning it, and then go from there. And, you know, yes, there will be greater works to be done, but right now as a body, we're not exercising the works themselves. So, you know, you can't put the cart before the horse nor jump ahead in line. There are no shortcuts. There's no up, XXYY cheat code here. So you have to do things by testing the spirit, by the spirit. What spirit is that? The spirit of John 14 and 26 and Jeremiah 33 and 3. And by those things, you won't be fooled by anything coming down or out of the sky, the land, or the sea. And it's quite possible with the ringleader in charge that we have, and with the reality TV climate that politics has taken on, it appears, you know, it's very likely that we're going to see Project Bluebeam or some derivative or version of it, where, you know, it's going to be very necessary for folks to be able to discern, you know, what spirits are truly of the creator and what spirits are truly of the hater. And to let it be that simple, the man in the tombs and Gadarenes in the book of Luke chapter 8 verse 33 didn't have to ask Christ where to send the spirits, and Christ didn't even make any bones about it. It's interesting that the spirits asked to be cast into the swine. He could have denied them that. But I do believe that that was a case of sending those spirits back from whence they were called. An important thing in magic and witchcraft, the sorcery of the brotherhood, is directions, precious metals. These are things that are important in the quote unquote art of conjuring, as they believe it to be. And so they will call forth things from certain directions. They will use certain precious metals on their medallions and amulets, rings and things of this nature. They believe that this empowers them or gives them some power of the spirit realms, over the spirits, and that it helps them to open up the realms. And they also believe in calling forth or conjuring from out of the elements. There are those who can envision Baphomet by staring at a flame. And there are those who can invoke or evoke the powers of the air. That's fire. That's air. There are, of course, those who deal with necromancy. Sorcerers and witches who use herbs and the things of the earth to conjure, and folks who use dead bodies and bones and things of that nature and bury them into the earth for conjuring purposes. And of course, there are those spirits that are brought forth from the sea. And the greatest unexplored frontier is not outer space, it's inner space. The inner space between our ears and the inner space below the depths of the seas and the oceans. Mankind has only been, they say, 8 miles deep into the core of the earth, and they've only recently come up with the submarine and marine technology able that enables them to go, you know, to the very depths of the ocean, where the temperature and the climate is hostile toward most living things. And the things that they find down there look rather alien and, if you will, devilish and demonic. And we know that the Father is not the author of confusion, nor has he given us the spirit of fear. So you have to wonder where these gruesome and fearsome beasts, these Leviathan like beasts, and these horrible looking creations actually come from. And if there was some credence to that, the fallen ones not only tampered with the genetics of humankind, but also the genetics of plant and animal kind as well. And so you have to put all of those things together and into account. And, you know, there's not a lot of study on the spirits from the realm of earth or fire or air. And we certainly have evidence of the Prince of the Power of the Air. But there is certainly a lot of focus, I believe, on the marine spirit realm. And I just think it's because we are in such a prideful and Atlantean mindset as a civilization. And that is only indicative of that, that there are so many people who are being oppressed and possessed and depressed by the spirit of Leviathan, the king of the sons of pride, and the spirits that roll with Leviathan, the spirits that Leviathan opens up the unwitting to, and the spirits that open the unwitting up to Leviathan. Pride hits people with a blind side. You know, it makes you unable to see certain obvious things, and it usually rolls with denial. But remember, you know, we're raised in a civilization that exalts pride, one of the seven deadlies. So this is the reason for the focus on this marine realm, and for the focus on Aquaman now. And for the focus on the Aquarian Age. That is what New Age is really called, the Aquarian Age. And it is all about the rising of Atlantis, this Third Reich, this revisitation of the Roman Empire, renewed and Luciferianized. And they're trying to bring us into it. They've been doing so incrementally for so long that it does appear that they're stepping on the gas and increasing the pressure. The pressure bursts pipes and it makes diamonds. So stay encouraged. But most importantly, test the spirits by the spirits. Stay wise as serpents, but gentle as doves.
Throughout recorded history, mankind has dreamt of building the perfect society. An empire that might somehow satisfy the needs of every man. An ancient legend cast the shadows of one such society that is said to have existed long ago. 2,500 years ago, the Greek philosopher Plato set down a dialogue called the Critias. He recounted the story of an ancient Greek poet and statesman named Solon. Solon had journeyed to Egypt in search of wisdom to help the government of his beloved Greece. The Greeks had been beset with factions and troubles, so Solon took counsel from the priests of the city of Sais. An old priest told him, "O Solon, Solon, you Greeks are never anything but children. There is no old opinion handed down among you, nor any science that is white with age." The old priest then proceeded to tell him the story of the lost city of Atlantis. In the centuries that would follow, scholars and researchers have debated whether Plato's Atlantis was intended to be an account of real history or simply an allegorical myth. Some even suggest that Atlantis was really the antediluvian world, the wicked society destroyed by the wrath of God in the great flood of Noah. In the 20th century, Plato's account was further supported by Masonic philosopher Manly P. Hall. Hall claimed that Atlantis had once been a vast and mighty empire that extended to the whole world, a philosophic commonwealth of nations that one day was destined to be rebuilt. But who would rebuild it? And exactly who was Manly P. Hall?
Manly P. Hall was probably the most highly esteemed occultist and Freemason of the 20th century.
He understood the secrets of the ages long before he ever joined the Masons.
Was really the foremost authority on the occultist side of Freemasonry, the deep, dark side of Freemasonry, the one that most Masons never ascend to.
I can't really think of anybody close to him.
Manly P. Hall was one of the leading people within this whole other world that we talk about.
Hall authored over 200 books and is said to have given some 8,000 lectures on ancient philosophy. He is perhaps most remembered for his contribution to the mysterious brotherhood of Masonry. Upon his death in 1990, the Scottish Rite Journal, a Masonic publication, noted that he was often called, quote, Masonry's greatest philosopher. Among his teachings was that contained in Masonry and all the secret orders was the ancient wisdom of lost Atlantis. Hall wrote that for more than 3,000 years, secret societies had been laboring to create a background of knowledge necessary to the establishment of an enlightened democracy among the nations of the world. According to Hall, these societies could be traced back to ancient Egypt and had for centuries known of a secret place hidden from the eyes of common men, a place that would one day be revealed. In the 17th century, as settlers were colonizing the New World, Sir Francis Bacon, the leader of secret societies in England, set down his classic work, The New Atlantis. While archaeologists and treasure hunters have searched the globe looking for the lost continent, 400 years ago, Bacon, like many of his contemporaries, believed that Atlantis was America itself. While the Atlantis of Plato was a mighty empire known for the philosophy of its kings, Bacon would write of a nation governed by scientific achievement, filled with marvels and wonders never before seen.
Bacon was talking about this new nation, talking about submarines, talking about unimaginable weapons of war, talking about flying machines and tall buildings. How did he come into possession of this knowledge?
Did Francis Bacon outline the course of the new world before its time? And if so, by what power was he inspired to do so?
Bacon was the head of Freemasonry and Rosicrucianism.
He had a huge influence through being the chief of the Rosicrucian fraternity at the time. He had a huge influence on the birth of modern Freemasonry. And many of those Rosicrucians actually went into Freemasonry at that time to lift it up to its new level. And Freemasonry has a major influence on the founding of America.
Unless you understand the influence of the occult societies on the development of America, on the establishment of America, upon the course of America, why you get completely lost studying our history.
And they were the ones through which this work was being put into operation in England, in Europe, and eventually in America and the world.
So that America then could be used to lead the world into the philosophic empire.
Yeah, maybe Bacon had it right. Maybe Atlantis is not something yet to occur, but maybe it's occurring right now in America.
In his lifetime, Sir Francis Bacon referred to himself as the herald of a new age. He promoted a new universal order for the whole world. Can this be what early American founders referred to with the words Novus Ordo Seclorum, the new order of the ages? And does this vision affect America today?
When our founders declared a new order of the ages, they were acting on an ancient hope that is meant to be fulfilled.
As America marches forward, spreading democracy throughout the globe, is she merely promoting freedom or fulfilling an ancient plan? Is she following a course planned for centuries by men who believe she is chosen for a secret destiny? To understand the present and possibly the future, we look into the past as we unfold the secret mysteries of America's beginnings. Can America be the new Atlantis?
Yeah. Angry, no less.